Welcome to episode number 8 of season 2 of What If Harry Potter Was in Star Wars. Thank you for your support on the other parts of this series, and if you haven't seen any of those parts, or series 1, the links will be in the description below. Enjoy. Master Windu was the first to rush to Harry's body, blood covering his torso. Looking for any wound to hold back, Windu couldn't find any, and asks Yoda to check. Yoda also fails to find a wound, but searching Harry's sock, finds a jagged mirror. Looking into it, Yoda sees a flash of blue before it disappears. Lifting Harry into the air with the Force, Yoda keeps as much of Harry's blood in his body as possible before a pop resonated the streets. The wide eyes of Dobby emerged, his hands emitting house elf magic that begins to quickly heal Harry, quite oblivious to the presence of the Jedi. With another two quick pops, Dobby was back with a blood replenishing potion, and Harry stirred again, his exposed scars causing him to wince in pain. Dobby transfigures a nearby bin into a stretcher and applied Essence of Dittany onto the major wounds. Harry now sat upon the stretcher and formally introduced Dobby to the clones and Jedi. Dobby is not surprised, as he pulls out a copy of the Daily Prophet from his multicoloured clothes. The front picture is a giant picture of Harry, but in smaller print at the bottom was a ransom for the mysterious warriors. But before they could continue, they needed to heal. Harry in particular was exceptionally hungry. Moving inside an abandoned cafe, Dobby brings food for all of the group, re-energizing them all immediately, despite the Jedi being initially confused at the food. It was far different from anything at Dex's diner. The news in the Daily Prophet meant that Harry needed to move fast, despite the protests from his body. With a quick thanks to Dobby, who apparates, Harry gets up from his chair as the group hear the clattering of plates. Harry readies his wand, and the Jedi prepare their lightsabers. Now approaching the kitchen, Harry just manages to put up a shield charm in time as the wooden door came hurtling towards him. The door ricochets off of the wall and Yoda catches it with the Force before it could hit Commander Cody and throws it back towards the assailant. The assailant falls to the floor and the face reveals a snatcher. Harry is bemused. Was this an isolated attack? And how did they know they would be here? Harry's thoughts are interrupted by an ear-splitting sound. The whole cafe rumbled and the ground shook and they were in trouble. Harry has to think fast. Pointing his wand at the ceiling, Harry casts a powerful reductor curse, blowing a hole in the roof. The Jedi and the clones are sent upwards, and Anakin uses the Force to lift Harry out. Now standing on top of the roof, they are surrounded by a dozen or so broomsticks, each ridden by Death Eater. Immediately, spells came streaming towards the Jedi, and Harry could not go on the offensive, as he could only roll and dodge the curses. Something had to change. Now seeing the focus was away from him, Harry casts a quick disillusionment charm on himself, confusing the Death Eaters. Harry fires his disarming spell at one of the Death Eaters and sent him tumbling to the ground. Before the broom could shatter to the floor, Harry uses a summoning charm, and to his relief, it landed in the palm of his hand. Now able to fly, Harry began to fly circles and loops around the Death Eaters, altering the focus away from the Jedi. Anakin is the first to notice this, and raises his hand to choke the life out of two Death Eaters who collide into each other. Seeing Harry on a broomstick, Obi-Wan and Ahsoka take the two which have just fallen beside them and hop aboard. Although they are novices, their natural affinity with the Force helps their balance, and soon, Ahsoka gains enough confidence to stand on her broom and slices the head off Death Eaters, hopping from broomstick to broomstick. Soon the Jedi and the clones are done with the Death Eaters, and they each decide to take a broom to head back to the Leaky Cauldron. The scene is a lot different from their initial arrival. The exterior is unrecognisable, a charred mess. Extinguishing the remaining flames with a jet stream of water, Harry heads back into Diagon Alley, on the off chance any other Jedi had wandered in. The previously bustling street turns out to be empty, and Harry heads back outside. Doing a quick head count, Harry notices something is odd. Somebody is missing. They had not had any casualties thus far, but one recon trooper, Harry now identified, was missing. Anakin and Harry exchange expressions of confusion, but this look gradually turns to one of horror. There had been a traitor in the mix. That would explain all of the chance encounters with Death Eaters. But now was not the time to ask who or why the traitor had done this. They would surely have reported everything to Voldemort by now. Their cover was blown, and they had no choice but to attack. Hopping back onto their broomsticks, the flyers are suddenly flashed by several bright lights. Obi-Wan is not too pleased, as the typically exuberant Jedi Master Quinlan Vos stood on top of a Republic gunship. Beneath him were a whole legion of clones and Jedi, led by Kit Fisto among others. Now this was a better way of getting to Hogwarts. With everybody on board, Tech uses the information given by Harry to direct the gunship. The fast journey is a thoughtful one for Harry, wondering how he was going to find and destroy the remaining Horcruxes. He now knew fiendfire was an option, albeit a dangerous one. Thinking of his other options, he remembered Dumbledore had destroyed Gaunt's ring with Gryffindor's sword, but he had no idea where that was. However, one option which did remain was the safest, the basilisk fangs. He just hoped he would be able to speak Parseltongue to open the entrance to the Chamber of Secrets once more. Now approaching the coordinates of Hogwarts, Harry asked the driver to stop at Hogsmeade in order to draw less attention to them. Feeling the magical shield push against them, the ship drops down, and Harry turns around to face the Jedi and the clones. After he disabled the anti-muggle wards, there would be no going back. The Jedi and clones salute Harry, and he began to take down the wards. The real battle had now started. That is it for episode 8 of season 2 of What If Harry Potter Was in Star Wars. If you'd like to see a part 9 of this series, please like this video, and if you're new to this channel or my other channel, subscribe for more tips. And as always, leave a comment on what if you'd like to see next, and how I can improve my videos. Thank you very much for watching, and see you next time.